Good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us. I'm Abby Phillip, and I'll be your host tonight. I hope that you enjoyed that screening of Dreamland, the burning of Black Wall Street, really powerful film about a really important story. And of course, CNN is really proud to be partnering with the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture, where I am here in Washington, DC, to present that screening to you. And this new CNN film celebrates the Black cultural renaissance of Greenwood, of the Greenwood District in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And it also investigates the 100-year-old massacre that took place there. We are marking the centennial of that massacre in just a few days, in just about a week and a half, and the impact that it had on American history. So I do want you all who are watching at home to join the conversation. You can submit questions using the Q&A function that's on your screen, and we'll try to read them toward the end of our discussion. But first, I do want to welcome our esteemed panelists this evening. Joining me in this conversation is Paul Gardullo, who's the museum curator of the National Museum of African American History and Culture. We've got Regina Goodwin, the state representative representing Tulsa, Oklahoma, who is also a descendant of massacre survivors. Regina is the assistant minority floor leader and chair of the, and actually I think now former chair of the Oklahoma Legislative Black Caucus. And we also have Hannibal Johnson, who is an author, attorney, and consultant. Hannibal's 2020 book is called Black Wall Street 100, An American City Grapples with Its Historical Racial Trauma. So I do want to welcome all three of you to the conversation. Thank you all for being here. I actually just saw Regina a few days ago when I was in Tulsa. So it's always good to see her. And I do want to start with you, Regina, as we were just watching that incredible documentary. And as someone who is from Tulsa, as a descendant, as someone who has dedicated so much of her life to this story, I do wonder what you think of this moment for Tulsa, this moment in which all of a sudden the country and maybe even the entire world is talking about the race massacre for the first time. What do you make of that? I mean, I can't stop thinking about what you said at the end of the documentary, that you know, Tulsa still has, you know, a song to sing. And I feel like that's exactly where the city is right now.
Absolutely. Abby, always good to see you. And I think you're hitting the right notes, that we live here in Tulsa and we experience this every day. So for us to wake up every morning in Tulsa, Oklahoma, gives us hope. And we have hope because, quite frankly, we're still here. And the fact that I'm a descendant of 1921 race massacre survivors, the very fact that I am here means that my ancestors were blessed to live through that time. And so there's always going to be hope, and there's always going to be, Tulsa's always going to be full of possibility. That same ingenuity, that same tenacity, that same fortitude exists in Tulsa today. And I'm telling you, we're just grateful. So we can start there. We can always talk about the wrongs. We can always talk about the injustices. We can still certainly talk about reparations that we want to talk about. But every day we wake up, it tells us that we are descendants of survivors, and that says a lot.
Yeah. So Hannibal, what do you think is the reason that so many people, actually so many people I've spoken to in Tulsa, but people all across the country, they'll say, I have never heard of this, or I had never heard about this until a couple of months ago, a couple of years ago. Maybe they watched Watchmen on HBO and they saw it for the first time. Why do you think that is?
It really has to do with a web of somewhat complex psychological dynamics. So first of all, the massacre happened in 1921. In 1921, the city of Tulsa was on an upward trajectory. toward becoming the self-described oil capital of the world. So the city fathers were really intent on burying this mark on Tulsa's reputation, because they wanted Tulsa to be perceived as a cosmopolitan city. They wanted folks to come here, bring their business here, bring their families here. So they had an interest in minimizing it. There was also shame in some sectors of the white community, shame that they had allowed this to happen in the community on their watch. And for that reason, they didn't want to talk about it. There was post-traumatic stress disorder in the black community, anxiety and fear, anxiety over the trauma that this caused, fear that this sort of incident could recur. After all, a similar incident happened on a smaller scale in Rosewood, Florida in 1923. So it really could happen again. And the racial dynamics in America were such that sociologists and historians were talking about the nadir of race relations in America, the low point of race relations because of these race riots and lynchings all throughout the United States. So for all those reasons, the history went sub rosa, undercover, swept under the carpet for many, many years. And there were really three essential openings, I think. One was the publication of an article by a white fellow named Ed Wheeler in 1971 on the 50th anniversary. The second thing was a publication by Scott Ellsworth, Dr. Scott Ellsworth, professor at University of Michigan, of his book, Death in a Promised Land, based on his doctoral thesis. And then the third event was the release of the final report of the Oklahoma Commission to Study the Tulsa Race Riot of 1921. That report was released in 2001. Those were really openings in terms of the acknowledgement of this history. And that led in rather rapid succession to really important monumental changes in curriculum and other things that are still ongoing, but they're light years ahead of where we were, say, 30 years ago.
And Paul, I wonder what your thoughts are on this as a historian and as someone, this is your life's work, this type of thing. One interesting aspect of the history of this massacre, well, several interesting aspects. One, it's the fact that so there's still uncertainty about what exactly happened, how many were killed, where are the bodies, you know, so many people fled. What is it like trying to piece together this history that was shrouded by a combination of so much shame and fear, especially in the black community? This was a place where, you know, the KKK was vibrant at that time and for years around the massacre. How difficult does that make your job as a historian in piecing this all together?
Well, that's right, Abby. And I think Hannibal is just right in the way he framed this. This is a story that has been suppressed and avoided. And it's been avoided in some respects, mostly by the wider white community. I wouldn't say it's necessarily been avoided within the black community over the generations from Tulsa. Clearly, Representative Goodwin came from a family of descendants who were adamant about making sure that this memory, both of the reverberations of the violence, but also the strong story of resilience, was central. And so when the museum started to think about, when we were conceived on the National Mall, its own history being suppressed for nearly 100 years, held in abeyance, we started to think about the stories that needed to be told, the silences that needed to be filled. And the head of our scholarly advisory committee at the Museum of African American History and Culture was John Hope Franklin. John Hope Franklin, preeminent American historian, Oklahoman, Tulsan, son of a riot survivor, was adamant about this story being a central story that the museum needed to showcase and tell on the National Mall. This story, both of the reverberations of destruction and white supremacy, but also this other beautiful story of survival and resilience. And so that's where my journey began. It began with going to Tulsa, beginning to talk to people about this project of filling the silences, talking to Regina Goodwin, talking to Hannibal Johnson, talking to many of these friends that I'm seeing here on this film for tonight, Kevin Ross, right? Alicia Odawale. Gosh, there's so many more. It was Don Thompson. These people who have helped to keep this memory alive, because people did keep these memories alive, sometimes through the smallest of fragments. George Monroe, who we heard from in that film, at 5 years old, collected pennies off of the ground, saved them for his entire life, and began to give them away when people were ready to listen. And the National Museum displays some of those pennies, right? To me, those are national treasures. Y'all can take and visit the ruby slippers. Give me George Monroe's pennies, right? I think those fragments of history can speak volumes about what we think we don't know and about what we still have yet to learn, because history still lives in this community. And it's all of that history. It's fragments from the destruction, but it's also those stories of resistance and resilience and survival and thriving. And I'm so glad to see that our little bit of telling the story is now kind of taking shape and helping to amplify the kind of work that Regina and Hannibal are doing on the ground right now in Tulsa.
Yeah. So Regina, I do want to, Paul was just talking about the resilience of people, the people of Greenwood and Tulsans, and your family is an example of that resilience. Can you tell us about what the impact of this massacre was through the lens of your family from a generational perspective? How did it impact your forefathers and yourself potentially even?
I think, Abby, that it was a story, as I listened to the piece, there are those that said they'd always known about this story, and that was pretty much our story in the Goodwin family. It was history that impacted our family because they were blessed to live through it. But going back, you know, four generations to my great-grandfather, James Henry, great-grandmother, Carly Marie Goodwin, my grandfather, Ed Goodwin, and aunt, great-aunt, Anna Goodwin. And knowing, hearing the stories of hearing that trouble's coming when they were seniors in high school, let's go back to my grandfather, and knowing that they were doing what everybody else typically would do, where you're just trying to graduate from high school, it's celebratory, and to hear that trouble was coming, and to know that what that would mean in their lifetime would be the greatest reign of racial terror on American soil, and the resultant arson and murder. And they were in high school. And I think about how young everybody was. You know, you talk about, you know, Sarah Page, Dick Rowland. We're talking about teenagers. We're talking about my grandfather at that time, teenagers, and how that impacted their lives and how they passed those stories on to us. And I remember being a small girl and hearing the stories about people leaving with just the clothes on their backs, trying to get away from all of this destruction, hearing about how people helped each other, hearing, you know, the story of two people praying and their last moments in life, praying to a God, and they would be shot in the back of the head, but they had a faith that carries on even till this day. Those are the stories that were passed on to me through my family, through understanding that, you know, we had businesses that were destroyed, and my great-grandmother had the courage and a faith in God that said, we've worked for what we have, and we are due what we've worked for. So she would go down to the courthouse when murderers were still walking on the street. And so it's that kind of storytelling. It's that kind of lived experience that's passed on to us. And we can do no less than to get the story right, first of all, get the story right, and to pass it on to others, because it is that resilience and it is that tenacity that will carry any generation through anything that comes. So I am just grateful that I had that kind of upbringing, and it serves us well today when racism, even today, is being amplified. It's being magnified. So what we're going through today, we've experienced before through generations past, and we are, I believe, equipped to deal with whatever we have to face.
I want to start going to some of the questions that we're getting in from the audience. And one of them is interesting because it's referring back a little bit to what we were discussing earlier, which is the many unknowns about what happened during the massacre and after the massacre, who was killed. And this person asks, does the American Red Cross have any helpful archival records for this history? And Hannibal, I see you nodding, and I believe the answer to that is yes, right?
Yes, the answer is yes. The American Red Cross did a thorough, a comprehensive report post-massacre. The Red Cross was led by a fellow named Maurice Willows, who was sent here from St. Louis. And by all accounts, black and white, the Red Cross did a yeoman's job in terms of post-massacre relief. They were deemed angels of mercy in letters and correspondence that are included in the final report from the Red Cross. And Paul probably has a copy of the Red Cross right there in the Smithsonian, right, Paul?
Were they
we
able
do,
to?
We do, and in fact,
yeah. Go ahead, Paul.
Ahead, Abby. No, I was saying, in fact, I think Scott Ellsworth might have brought it in when he did his work in the Smithsonian in the 1990s. And what's valuable to remember is even as important as the Red Cross was, right? And this is why it's so important to center the stories of survivors, is that Dr. Olivia Hooker talks about her father gathering with the head of the then YMCA, Archie Green, and creating a tour of black churches, a national tour in the immediate aftermath of the riot that was funding relief efforts, right? And that relief was coming in barrels from black folks all around the nation to Tulsa. Wow. In June of 1921. Even as the Red Cross was mobilizing. So it is this kind of multifaceted effort that we're going to begin to sort of, that I think there's more work to be done in digging up, although there's been a tremendous amount of history already done, especially within the archives.
Yeah. Do the Red Cross records do any tabulating of the injured, of the dead, of the missing, or anything like that?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. And so when you, I think I would challenge your the supposition of your original question, because I don't think there are that many critical unanswered questions. The biggest unanswered question, of course, is something that's probably indeterminate, which is the number of people who were killed. I think we'll never know that with exactitude. Mm-hmm. I think we can get closer to it by doing things like the mass graves investigation and so forth. But many of the other critical questions surrounding what happened and when and so forth have been answered. Now, identities of parties who perpetrated the violence, that's a big, probably unanswerable question. We have clues, and we know that the Klan had a great presence in Tulsa. We know that Tulsa society was really in bed with the Klan back in that period. We know all that. But we don't know particular names and the specific actions they took in those fateful hours. That's what we don't know. The main thing we
don't know. Well, I'll add one more thing that I think, if you watch this documentary, you hear some discussion of this, but the kind of match that set this all off was this alleged incident between Dick Rowland and Sarah Page. And there is some, you know, I don't even know how to put it, uncertainty about what happened to them, about their relationship, if they had one. Maybe they did, maybe they did not. There's a lot of interesting, there's a lot there that is interesting. And it's really unanswered. I mean, do you ever think that we will find out more definitively about, especially this is the era of DNA testing and ancestry.com and all of that stuff? I mean, will we ever find out more about what happened to these two individuals who, by all accounts, more or less disappeared from Tulsa after all of this.
Can I just say, want to say one thing about that. And yeah. The thing I want to say is, the incident between Dick Rowland and Sarah Page, if you listen to what Dr. Alicia Ottawali said, I think it's absolutely true. So in many ways, the Sarah Page-Dick Rowland incident is a red herring. I mean, that's not the cause of what happened in Tulsa in 1921. It's a trigger incident. It's a catalyst. There were a number of other deep, abiding, structural factors in Tulsa that are causative in terms of the massacre.
Yeah. Regina, do you have any thoughts on this?
I would say this, that absolutely that situation was used as a trigger, but as I already said, there were systems in place. Racism was quite prominent, evident as it is today, and that really, in a thriving Black community, and animosity and a jealousy that had persisted for a while in that community, all of that has would come bubbling to the surface. But I do think this is important, that as I reflect on that story and what I was told, right? Then I know Hannibal knows of the relatives of the Dick Rowland family that talk about a relationship that existed, right, in Sunday dinners at grandmother's house where Sarah Page would be with Dick Rowland.
And
with that backdrop, right? Then you have to ask yourself, in that day, a Black man who was accused of assault, how was it that he did not suffer? How is it that he was not penalized in any way individually? And so I think there is something to that relationship with Sarah Page. I think she did vouch for him. I think he knew some very influential people, as that has been told, because the shoes that he shined were the shoes of men that were very influential in the community. So I think there are connections there. And I think that the entire town burned down based off of a lie. And the end result was that a Black man and a Black woman left Tulsa, Oklahoma. And what they left behind was a city in ruins. So I think, to your point, Abby, I think as we uncover more and speak to more folks, I think we get a little closer to the truth in terms of what had happened, because the fact that he escaped with his life when we lost so many other lives, I think that in itself speaks volumes.
And I think that what's interesting is the way in which the only relationship that those two people could have had was already a narrative written. The only relationship that society could have envisioned for them, white society at that time, was that of a male aggressive Black male rapist and a white female victim. Regardless of what that relationship was, we may never know. And so what's valuable is to understand that, how that narrative developed, and how that kind of a narrative comes to replace the more systematic sort of racism that we need to unpack, but also replace the real human stories, the real stories that, you know, we ought to be looking at as well. Dick Rowland's life, his family's life, as well as the Williams family's lives and the way they struggled, and on like that. And so I like the way in which people are attracted to the human stories around this. It's just that I'm going to use a word I probably shouldn't use, but that story is so overdetermined, right? That it is difficult for us to kind of take it much further. Although I think, Regina, you brought it to the most enlightenment that I've ever heard, which is great.
What is also, I think, important about that, you know, that part of the story, is that it is a conceit of racism that we've been living with for so long. That, I mean, this happened in 1921, and then decades later, Emmett Till was killed over a similar accusation, and decades after that, more you know, uncountable numbers of Black men have been accused of, you know, violating white women, and that being the predicate for violence against Black people and Black communities. So that's the part of the story that is just so consistent over time in American history, that is, and you know, you can't forget that part of it when you tell the story of the Tulsa massacre, because that's part of it too. We have another question. Yeah, go ahead, Regina.
No, go ahead. Very recently, very quickly, you had Amy Cooper and Christian Cooper in New York, and he was bird watching, and he was accused of attacking Amy Cooper very recently.
Yeah.
So same narrative 100 years later.
Yeah, exactly. In New York City in the year 2020. So it's really incredible that these things do not, they have not gone away in any way, shape, or form. I want to get to this other question from a viewer who asks, what is the one thing you want viewers, most of whom probably have not ever heard of this event, to take away from the film? And I think that this is probably a good question, tough question, maybe, for you all to end on. I don't know who wants to go first, but take it away.
I will. So I've been addressing this history for more than two decades. And what's fundamentally important for me is that people understand, and Regina alluded to this earlier, the overarching narrative here is the story of the indomitable human spirit. It's not the massacre. The massacre is a chapter in a grand narrative that involves incredible people of character, and a remarkable community that they created that was dubbed Black Wall Street. And so the massacre is an event that really ultimately attests to their resilience, their faith, their hope, and their fortitude.
And I would say, anytime somebody says, if you could take, what one thing would you take away? We always, what we've learned, we're descendants of folks from Greenwood, so we never get boxed in to one answer, right? Things happen to be one way. You have to be creative. You have to be, I think, meet the moment. And I think if you take away numerous things from this Greenwood story, you're gonna talk about your independence, right? And the independence of the human spirit and what can be achieved. And you're going to also talk about what does it mean to be productive in society and to give and share with each other. There are numerous lessons out of that. And I would ask that the viewer that's asking the question, really, what I'd like to know is what affected that person the most? What stuck with them as they watched the documentary? And that would be most telling, because it tells us a bit about where they are in their life right now, and perhaps what they will, what's aspirational for them? What are their hopes and dreams?
Yeah. It's a beautiful answer. And I think if I were to take one more thing away, because I think what you all said is the thing, is the takeaway. But I think in addition, the second takeaway is that one woman, and I'm sorry, I can't remember her name, he said, tell it right. Tell it right. And part of telling it right is if we're going to talk. Yes. Eldoris is the granddaughter. Yeah. You know, and part of telling the story right is if we're going to talk about resilience and resilience among Black folks in Greenwood and around this nation, we also have to talk about the resilience of racism. Damn, it's resilient. And we can't, and it's changeable and mutable, and we can overcome that, right? By looking to stories like we see in Greenwood.
Yeah.
Can I say this on behalf of Joy McCondishy, because she's not here right now? Oftentimes our history, if it's not told accurately, there's a retelling and a false retelling. And if we don't own our own stories and tell them, they can be skewed. And two, out of respect for Joy, what she often would say is tell it right, don't tell it white. And what she meant by that is if the story is going to be somehow co-opted by folks that don't know the story, that have not studied it, if that happens to be a white person that is going to diminish the story in any way, if it's going to be told like that. She doesn't want that. I would not want that. So that she's very known for saying that. And out of respect to her quote, as it is, she says, tell it right. Don't tell it white.
That note that you ended on is, I'm just going to add my two cents a little bit on this because, last summer I spent some time in Tulsa. I was back there last week, spent some time with Regina. But what always sticks with me about being in Tulsa is obviously the resilience of the Black community, the interconnectedness of the Black people in Tulsa, and people like Regina who continue to push the story forward and working toward keeping the story of Greenwood alive. But in 2021, I think there is an important takeaway about white America, white Tulsa, and the work that needs to be done to bring everybody along with understanding and recognizing and that history and being on board with what justice really looks like in Tulsa. And when you're in that city, you can't help but notice that it's like living in two different worlds. When you're in Greenwood, you're in one world. When you're in the downtown part of Tulsa, you're in another world. And there's a lot of work to be done. And that's a microcosm of, I think, what's happening in this country, which is that, we want to only hear our own histories. And more people, white people, need to understand the true history of things like what happened in Tulsa and what happened all over the country over the last century and what is still happening today. There's a lot of work to do. And I think films like the CNN documentary are part of that work. Bringing this story to living rooms all over the country is a critical part of that work. And so it's great to see that more people are learning about this. Because I think that knowledge is incredibly powerful. And having the people who know the story best and know the story well telling it is also really, really important. I do want to thank, yeah. Go ahead, Regina.
I cannot, if you would allow, I have to speak the names. Oftentimes you say their names when folks have been tragically murdered. I've got to say the names of Miss Leslie Benningfield Randall, 106, Miss Viola Ford Fletcher, 107, and Mr. Hughes Van Ellis, 100 years old. They are the known survivors of the 1921 race massacre, and we're blessed to still have them with us. So as we tell this story, they are telling their own story. So I certainly want to pay tribute to them.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, it's incredible that in their hundreds, they're still around to tell the story. So thank you for saying that, Regina. And thank you, Hannibal and Paul, also for being with us tonight. And thank you all for joining us virtually for this advanced screening of Dreamland, The Burning of Black Wall Street. I want to give a special shout out and thank you so much to the Smithsonian National History of African American History and Culture for being such great partners. Really excited for the Smithsonian doors to be finally open again in a post-COVID world. I think we're all ready for that. And Dreamland, The Burning of Black Wall Street will premiere on CNN and it will simulcast in Spanish on CNN en Español on Monday, May 31st at 9 p.m. Eastern time. I believe that is Memorial Day. So you'll be able to tune in on that day. We hope that you'll watch it again and tell your friends about it. And you can actually join the conversation about this film using the hashtag DreamlandTulsa. So hashtag DreamlandTulsa. Thank you all so much for being with us tonight. I hope you enjoyed the film and this discussion, and I hope you tell everyone you know to take a moment and watch it. You won't regret having done that. Thank you and good night.